These men and women have come home to Greece after 30 years exile in Eastern Europe. Between 1947 and 1949, they fought on the left in a bitter and tragic civil war in Greece. They lost, and now for the first time, they can tell their story.
When we came back to the village, we were talking about the civil war and remembering the evil that happened. Brother killed brother. Is there anything worse than that? There isn't. We lost so many children in the civil war. 80 children were killed in this village. And brother fought brother.
I can't forget everything. Every night I go to bed and I talk to myself. I start from the beginning and I go all the way through to the end.
Late in 1940, the Italians invaded Greece. The Greeks repelled them, and for a while were Britain's only ally against the German-Italian axis. But in May 1941, after the fall of Crete to German troops, the whole of Greece came under Nazi control. The Greek king and his government fled abroad.
We didn't want to be humiliated after our victory against the Italians. It wasn't just the students who felt it. All Greeks felt the same. We didn't want the swastika, the symbol of fascism, to infect the Acropolis. We were so shocked to see it up there that we wanted to bring it down. We chose the day when the Germans occupied Crete. The moment Crete was occupied, we said, we must take it down, now.
The resistance against the German occupation started within weeks. It was also a national liberation movement against the return of the dictatorship of General Metaxas, who had ruled Greece from 1936, and against the return of the king who had supported him.
People hated the dictatorship of Metaxas and the king. Together they oppressed the Greek people. We didn't want in any way to go back to the same tyrannical regime which was supported from abroad after the liberation. That regime was hated by all Greeks.
The Greek dictator, General Metaxas, had intended that his regime should revive the glories of the Greek past, but there had been disturbingly fascist overtones. Political opposition had been crushed, opponents interned, and civil liberties denied. In September 1941, the Greek Communist Party, KKE, formed the National Liberation Front, AAM. It became the largest resistance movement. Recruitment was by word of mouth.
AAM was organized by those who had been exiled to the islands by Metaxas and who had escaped. They came and immediately organized the first resistance against the occupation forces. I was an engineer, and I joined because a colleague in our office told me, you know, there is a resistance organization which got started at the Albanian front. And immediately we got organized.
My brother was an old prisoner of the Metaxas dictatorship. As soon as he came back from the Albanian front, where we had beaten the Italians, he said, don't just sit there, you must join. And he immediately put me in touch with someone who was organizing resistance amongst actors.
When the Allies imposed a trade blockade on occupied Europe, Greece was particularly hard hit. In the winter of 1941, 300,000 Greeks died of hunger.
It was a fight for survival and food. The first thing we did was to organize free meals. The National Survivor Committee was the best idea AM ever had. We threatened general strikes, and we forced the Nazis to start giving free meals and a portion of oil every day.
By early 1942, ELAS, the military arm of AM, was building up pockets of armed resistance in the mountain villages.
The person around whom the AM organization was formed was the local Communist Party representative. We were liberals. We belonged to the bourgeois parties. So we hadn't got a clue about underground organizing. The Communist Party, of course, had its own structure and was highly organized. It didn't bother us in the least that it was the Communist Party representative who was organizing us. On the contrary, we worked very well together throughout the struggle against the Axis occupation.
In the village of Ziakas in central Greece, almost the entire population joined ELAS to fight the Italian occupying forces.
The Italians used to come into the village and beat people. We fled from the village and hid in the mountain. The children were crying from hunger. The goals of ELAS were to set us free. We were all peasants, and when we were asked to join the resistance, we did so with heart and soul. We looked after the wounded. We baked bread all night. We knitted, washed, and transported things. Whatever was necessary, really.
When we came back to the village from the mountain, the Italians had killed all the pigs and cows we hadn't been able to take with us. There was nobody here. Everyone had gone to the mountain. The whole village, when we came back, it was deserted.
In the mountains, recruitment to ELAS was done openly, often inspired by Aris Veloukiotis, a communist who had been imprisoned by Metaxas.
When Aris Veloukiotis came here in 1942 with about 60 or 70 of his ELAS partisans, we all gathered in the square with people who had come from surrounding villages. Aris began to explain the goals of AM, which were to get everyone to work together to liberate Greece.
He said that anyone could join AM ELAS, regardless of their political beliefs. He also told us that he would attack the occupying forces at any opportunity, that he didn't know what kind of reprisals would follow, but that we should be prepared to try and defend ourselves. Some of the villagers followed him and became partisans. The rest helped the resistance in different ways.
We helped, for instance, at the hospital, washing the clothes and linen, whatever was needed.
I was a teacher, so I moved around from one village to another. I taught the children and tried to instill national pride in them. We prepared the older ones to join ELAS. At the same time, we developed the cultural life in the village. We set up theaters with plays and songs for the children.
On the whole, the clergy in the countryside supported ELAS enthusiastically. Wherever they went, the village priest was always the first to welcome the partisans. Many monasteries were used as hospitals for the wounded partisans. Whatever monasteries had, like animals and food, they gave to ELAS.
Success in skirmishes against the Italian forces brought in more volunteers. But the price of this resistance was high.
Ήμασταν τότε ένα τμήμα ανταρτών καμιά τριανταπενταριά.
By then, we were a group of about 35 ELAS partisans, and we were in the mountain villages of Vanasidas. The occupying forces have been reinforced by units of collaborators who were trying to collect attacks from us.
Την κυβέρνηση των κατακτητών με σκοπό να συγκεντρώσουν τη δεκάτη, δηλαδή τη φορολογία.
We attacked them then and managed to disarm them and take the food they got and distribute it amongst the villages.
By now, ELAS was a widespread resistance movement, and in grim conditions was tying down large numbers of German units. It was at this time that British plans for post-war Greece began to clash with those of AM ELAS, and the seeds of the Greek civil war were sown.
The Foreign Office view of the ELAS guerrillas was that they were the military arm of a communist front organization, EAM. As such, they were primarily interested in establishing themselves in such a way as to be able to seize power when the Germans withdrew. The main problem was that we had an interest, a long-standing interest, in Greece as part of the Mediterranean, with our lines of communication through to India, Suez Canal, Egypt. We did not want to see Greece handed on a platter to Joe Stalin along with the rest of the Balkans.
Οι Άγγλοι από την πρώτη στιγμή τους έδειξαν εχθρική.
EAM's goal was to make Greece independent, free from all ties.
Έβαζε στα σκοπό του την εθνική ανεξαρτησία, την επαλλαγή από κάθε δέσμευση.
We knew from the start that the British wanted to keep Greece within their sphere of influence in the Mediterranean for their own political ends. EAM was opposed to this, and so the British were against us from the start.
In Greece, as in Yugoslavia, the British were confronted with a dilemma. How could they reconcile their short-term military need to work with left-wing resistance movements with their longer-term political objectives of retaining influence in Greece after the war? Churchill believed that the return of the Greek king would be the best guarantee of British interests in Greece. Had there been a powerful royalist resistance in the mountains, there would have been no problem, but in Greece there was none. So the British decided to back a pro-British resistance. Napoleon Zervas was to lead what became Greece's second largest resistance group, ELAS. But Zervas only agreed to go to the mountains after being given a 48-hour ultimatum by the British, that unless he went, they would denounce him to the Germans as their agent. The British then sent in a team of SOE saboteurs to set up headquarters with ELAS.
ELAS's attitude to us when we arrived, and for that matter, EAM, the political component as well, I think they were highly embarrassed when we arrived because they were doing very well without us.
We were expecting the British as our allies to help us in any way possible. But in fact, they tried to divide us into groups all under British control.
What SOE planned to do with the Greek resistance was to set up more or less independent, small-scale guerrilla bands in all parts of the country, whose activities would be coordinated through British liaison officers who would in turn be under the control of our GHQ in Cairo. This was quite different from the intention of ELAS in particular, which was to set up a large-scale conventional army under centralized control inside Greece, which would eventually form the hard core of a post-war army in Greece under left-wing control. There was therefore difficulty in reconciling their purposes with our purposes.
From the moment the English became involved, they had one aim, to hurt the operations of ELAS, so that Churchill would be able to impose his plan to get the Greek king back in power, and through him, perpetuate Britain's hold over Greece.
In spite of their opposed views, ELAS and the British sometimes worked together with great success, using captured German war materials and British supplies. In November 1942, in a combined operation, SOE, ELAS and EVES blew up the Gogopotamos Bridge, which cut Rommel's supply line to Africa for six crucial weeks just before the Battle of Alamein. Meanwhile, the British continued to try to win support for the return of the Greek king. Yorgos Papadopoulos, a leading liberal, was invited to dinner with the British military mission.
We talked about various things. Then the last question the colonel asked me was, why don't you want your king back? I said we don't want him back because he supported the Metaxas dictatorship in 1936, which denied us any freedom of speech and took away all civil rights. And I'm asking you, if your king did such things to you, would you want him? He didn't answer me on that.
Wherever we went, it was quite obvious that ELAS, either or both, feared that we would reimpose the King of Greece under the protection of British bayonets when Greece was liberated.
In March 1943, the widely respected Stephanos Sarafis was given the military command of ELAS. However, SOE's successful cooperation with ELAS did little to alter Foreign Office opinion that the main goal of the Greek resistance was to establish a communist regime in Greece after the war.
The Foreign Office would have preferred that there should be no resistance whatever. At one point, a leading official in the Foreign Office wrote a minute saying that the best level of sabotage in Greece would be no sabotage at all.
The Greek government in exile was based in Cairo. In August 1943, Brigadier Eddie Myers took a mixed delegation of resistance partisans there to discuss the future of the Greek king. Discussions broke down when the partisans, together with most of the Greek government in exile, demanded that he should agree to a referendum before his return to Greece.
Well, this was an anathema to the king of Greece himself, and it was an anathema to the Foreign Office, obviously. And the king of Greece became extremely worried and signaled Churchill and Roosevelt, who were then at Quebec conference, and they said, oh, you stick fast, no need to sign away your abdication at this stage of the game.
The resistance delegation was dismissed as both irrelevant and embarrassing and was sent back to the mountains. For his pains, Myers was recalled to London and sacked. That same month, August 1943, at Quebec, the Allies decided they wouldn't need to involve Greece in any major military operations, and the Greek resistance therefore became less important. In Moscow in October, Stalin indicated to Anthony Eden that he was not concerned with Greece. This enabled the British to put their long-term political considerations in Greece first. In the War Cabinet in November 1943, it was decided to destroy the power of EAM ELAS leaders and to build up the power of ZEVAS, now a royalist. In Greece itself, the continuing hostility between EVES and ELAS erupted into open conflict.
Once the fighting broke out between ELAS and EDES in October 1943, the British authorities decided that ELAS was solely to blame for this outbreak, and therefore SOE was instructed to cut off all supplies to ELAS until the fighting ceased.
ELAS blamed EVES and accused it of collaborating with the Germans.
ZEVAS certainly had a means of contact with the Germans. He had at least a couple of officers who were members of ELAS, stationed quietly in Janina, which was General Lanz's headquarters, General Lanz being the German commander, And these officers were certainly in irregular contact with Luntz and with Luntz's staff.
The war in Europe still had over a year to run. In Greece, a truce was arranged in January 1944 between the two resistance groups. Meanwhile, ELAS had begun to organize society in the territory it had liberated. In April, it set up a provisional government in the mountains. Elections were held, and women were given the vote for the first time.
I remember that the government made beautiful things happen, and we were raised to a higher level. The other governments had neglected the peasants. Beautiful things happened, like voting. I voted, and we helped in the local government in any way we could.
Η αλληλοεξάρτηση και η κατανόηση που είχε δημιουργηθεί.
The solidarity and understanding that were generated up here in the mountains and the enthusiasm for self-government made people so much more aware and sophisticated that those of us who came up from Athens just couldn't believe it.
In Athena, και βρισκόταν σε αυτό το κλίμα, τα έχαναν. Και τότε δημιουργήσαν, να πούμε, τα λαϊκά δικαστήρια στα χωριά.
People's courts were set up in the villages, and I was selected to be a people's judge.
Βάλανε και εμένα δικαστή λαϊκών. Και κάναμε, να πούμε, τις διάφορες.
We judge various cases, things like property, mainly small cases, no murders or anything. I did my duty as I have been chosen, and I became a judge, although I was illiterate, of course. There were no lawyers here in the mountains. I don't know what was happening in the towns. Here in the villages, we didn't have to pay anyone acting as a lawyer. We only had people's judges, who judged according to their consciences.
In general, the people were very pleased with this people's government. We had general assemblies every month, and every villager could air his grievances and criticize the chairman or councillor when he didn't do his duty. We made decisions for the whole village. Whatever happened in the village, everyone had to know about it. That was how self-government worked.
When we started to govern ourselves, we got encouraged, and people woke up, so to speak. We became more active and took more responsibility for ourselves.
We wanted this government to agree to the separation of church and state, and that priests should complete secondary school and have theological degrees. In the meantime, we joined the resistance, and the churches contributed however they could.
There was no discrimination against women. All the girls were working in the resistance together, and the partisans respected the female sex. They had a lot of respect for us.
In April 1944, Greek troops in the British Army in Egypt mutinied in support of this provisional government. Churchill instructed the British commander to put down the mutiny. After 10 days without water, the Greeks surrendered, and the British sent 8,000 of them off to prison camps in Sudan, Egypt, and Libya. The British then hastily arranged a conference in Lebanon, at which they hoped to set up a national government acceptable to Eyam Elas. The conference was a success. The British nominated the liberal politician George Papandreou to be prime minister, and the delegation from the provisional government in the mountains agreed to a coalition government under him, in which they would have 6 out of 24 seats. The British were very optimistic, but in Greece the news was greeted with dismay by the Elas partisans, who now controlled 4/5 of their country.
Υπέγραψε το Λίβανο αναγνωρίζοντας τα κόμματα τα οποία δεν διέθεταν παρά μονάχα μια, πώς να το πούμε, παλιά.
Our delegation signed the Lebanon Agreement, which gave authority to the old political parties when they had no power in Greece at all.
Να συμμετάσχουν με έξι υπουργούς.
By then, ΕΑΜ was the most powerful political force. And yet, the delegation agreed to participate in a government where they only had 6 out of 24 seats. That was the first step in the downfall of our movement.
Although the conference was judged a success, the British were still worried about the extent of ΕΑΜ ELAS's power. In August, Churchill wrote, "It is most desirable to strike out of the blue without any preliminary crises. It is the best way to forestall ΕΑΜ." In October 1944, he went to Moscow to firm up Allied plans for post-war Europe. With Stalin, he made what became known as the percentage agreement, giving Britain 90% influence in Greece in exchange for the Soviet Union having 90% influence in Romania. In good humor, Churchill told Stalin, "It's a pity God didn't seek our opinion when he built the world." To which Stalin replied, "This was God's first mistake." In Greece, as liberation approached, tension mounted between ELAS and the British. One bone of contention was the British attitude to Greek collaborators who had worked with German security forces.
Our attitude was, and we met them before the Germans left, to say if they did not surrender their arms and surrender themselves, they would be arrested and tried as collaborators. We did our best to get them to surrender.
When we started the negotiations, we were putting pressure on Michalaras and the others, who could see that there was no way out of surrendering their arms. At that moment, the English officer intervened and said, "You surrender your arms if you want to, or if you don't want to, you don't have to." The negotiations came to an end, and we realized that the Englishman had turned the tables on us, and so the collaborators didn't surrender their arms.
We failed, I think, because they feared we were too few in number to protect them from ELAS. ELAS would have allowed us to take their surrender if they, ELAS, had taken their arms. In the event they did not surrender, in the event they should have been arrested as collaborators. I think about that time, the attitude of ELAS to us did begin to change. I suppose a single incident brought home to me the change of attitude when Ypsilantis, then a very senior ELAS commander, made what was one of the great Greek gestures of contempt when he tugged his lapel in referring to British troops, which is one of the most contemptuous gestures in the very rich Greek vocabulary of gesture. It surprised me then, it surprised me now, it surprises me now, and I think the only reason one can give is that ELAS began to see that the British, who were then expected to come in to the Peloponnese initially, could be a factor, an obstacle to their intention of taking over power.
They usually accuse ELAS of wanting to seize power. It's a stupid view. There was a power vacuum in Greece. There were occupying forces and quisling prime ministers, but the Greek people didn't recognize their governments.
Αλλά ο λαός δεν αναγνώριζε αυτούς ως κυβερνήτες.
The people were creating their own popular power in their own right through the resistance.
Απελευθερώνοντας τις περιοχές, δημιουργούσε τη δική του λαϊκή.
ΕΑΜ didn't try to take power. ΕΑΜ had power.
Το ΕΑΜ την είχε την εξουσία.
I have no doubt at all that they could have occupied Athens at the time when the Germans left, and they could have made it very difficult for Allied forces to return to Greece without having to face an opposed landing.
In October 1944, 4 months after D-Day, with the Allies on the offensive throughout Europe, the Germans were forced to pull out of Greece, and the British entered unopposed. The swastika came down from the Acropolis, and in spite of some misgivings, all Greeks welcomed the British troops.
When we got to Athens itself, although we hadn't actually seen a German, we were treated as though we were conquering heroes. And across the roads there were banners saying, "Hip, hip, the British troops." There were posters and streamers from the trees. The walls were all marked with welcoming signs. And as we walked along the streets, we were cheered, we were hugged. Sometimes we were kissed. People came up and gave us flowers.
Ήτανε μέρες ενθουσιασμού, χαράς.
These were days of enthusiasm and joy.
Και όταν...
We poured onto the streets, and when we saw the English for the first time on the tanks, in the vehicles,
ήτανε τέτοια...
our joy was such that I remember feeling that they were my brothers, my friends, liberators. I trusted them. I remember we danced together. I don't know whether we were dancing English or Greek dances, but we were dancing and kissing.
But within 6 weeks, the British were in armed combat with ELAS and its reservists in Athens. It had been agreed that a new Greek army would be formed, and the argument was over who was going to be in it. For the British, the question was how to disarm ELAS. And for ELAS, it was how to retain its military power on at least an equal footing with the royalist Greek troops then returning from Italy.
I can remember them marching down the main street of Athens and our great relief that at last Greek troops had come in and we were not the only people responsible. This was a turning point. Of course, in a way, you might say that for the communists who were participating in the government, it might be regarded as a little bit provocative, in the sense that they realized that the head of their government, in which they were participating, was bringing his army in.
Σκοπό είχαν με αυτές τις δυνάμεις του σταγματασφαλίτης.
The British and the Greek governments, along with the royalist troops, wanted to restore the old order in Greece.
Τους Εγγλέζους που είχαν έρθει ακόμα από τον Οκτώβριο στην Αθήνα να επαναφέρουν στην Ελλάδα την παλιά τάξη πραγμάτων, να ξαναθρονιάσουν τον βασιλιά ξανά στην εξουσία.
They wanted the king back on his throne because he was the best guarantee of British interests in Greece, political, economic and strategic.
Των οικονομικών και των στρατηγικών των Εγγλέζων στην Ελλάδα.
Churchill was adamant in his support for the king's return and wrote to Eden that having paid the price we have to Russia for freedom of action in Greece, we should not hesitate to use British troops to support the Royal Hellenic Government. I fully expect a clash with EAM, and we must not shrink from it, provided the ground is well chosen. Negotiations between the Greek government and ELAS about the composition of the new army continued with bad faith from both sides. On December the 2nd, the Prime Minister George Papandreou banned an EAM demonstration against his demobilization plans. The EAM ministers in the government resigned and the demonstration went ahead. It was to end in tragedy.
At about 2 minutes past 11, the police suddenly opened fire on them. And they killed 11 or 12 people. Altogether. There was a man called Frank Pattenham, who was a British policeman, whose job it was to help to train the new Greek police forces being set up, who went along in front of the police and kicked their guns up to stop them firing at the crowd. They were not firing over the head of the crowd, they were firing into the crowd.
And suddenly, as we were in Constitution Square, we heard for a moment the machine guns, and the first dead. I ran to take photographs, but I didn't know what was happening. I mean, who were these people killed and by whom? What was happening? Later, within seconds, people gathered, and knelt and started to sing the funeral march with fists high up in the air.
On December the 4th, ELAS attacked the police stations. On the 5th, Churchill instructed General Scobie, "Do not hesitate to act as if you were in a conquered city, where a local rebellion is in progress. We have to hold and dominate Athens, with bloodshed if necessary." The following day, the British came in on the side of the Greek government. British troops seized the headquarters of EAM, and from then on, it was open warfare between the British and ELAS.
They tried to stop us taking action against the security battalions who had collaborated with the Nazis. Men who the British first regarded as enemies and then later as their allies. Later, on the 6th of December, I was at the Makrigiannis battle. For me, the battle was an experience, a school, a university. For the first time, I understood what fanaticism meant. Rational thinking stops. Man is beyond himself. He cannot think, cannot function rationally.
In the next few weeks, over 4,000 civilians were to die. In the House of Commons, Churchill faced a vote of censure for his actions in Greece. Justifying British armed intervention, he claimed that ELAS had planned to march down upon Athens and seize it by armed force, and that it would have been incompatible with British honour to leave Athens to anarchy and misery, followed by tyranny established on murder. While the arguments went on in London, the battle for Athens continued. The bulk of ELAS was in northern Greece, fighting the royalist Zervas, who had to be rescued by the British and evacuated to Corfu. There were only 3 ELAS units in Athens. A week into the battle, the communist leadership was still undecided about what action to take and stopped short of ordering all-out attack against the British troops. Nevertheless, 25,000 reinforcements were sent in, and by December the 15th, the British had more than 50,000 troops in Athens.
In Italy, or in any other theatre of war, if you saw a German, you shot at him. I mean, you did your best to kill him, and if he saw you, he did his best to kill you. In Greece, we were a bit ambiguous about this, and so were they, I'm glad to say, as it turned out.
Well, I thought we'd come to liberate the Greeks, but within what seemed to be a short space of time, we were actually killing them. And more to the point, actually British chaps were dying in a cause that I couldn't quite understand.
I think what most of us felt was that we didn't like the idea of fighting against people who were on our side. It wasn't what we'd enlisted for. We would do anything we were told to do, but it wasn't a welcome idea. The Greeks were on our side. They'd fought beside us in Italy.
As the British stepped up their attack, civilian casualties mounted.
Στις 12 του Δεκέμβρη μας φώναξαν με τα χωνιά εκείνη την εποχή.
On the 12th of December, the Communist Party called us to a meeting in a school in Kypseli. We were to decide what line to take and whether to join in the fighting. I knew the British were involved, but I hadn't seen them in action until that day when they fired at us with rockets.
Εκείνη την ημέρα μας χτύπησαν. Μας χτύπησαν οι Άγγλοι.
10 people were killed, mainly students and actors. And 12 of us were seriously wounded, including myself.
Μεταξύ των οποίων ήμουν και εγώ, πολύ βαριά.
ELAS began to take hostages and shot many civilians whom they accused, often wrongly, of being collaborators. The British had already begun sweeping operations and took their prisoners to the prisoner of war camp at El Darba in Africa.
Εγώ το βράδυ, γυρίζοντας στο σπίτι, πιάστηκα.
On my return home in the evening, I was captured.
Λέγω λεπτομέρειες.
Without going into details, I was caught and sent to Africa. I found myself at El Daba. We were 28,000 of us there, surrounded by barbed wire. Among the mass of people in El Daba, there were all kinds of people. Most of them were not related to our movement. They did not belong to EAM. Let me tell you about a neighbor of mine who was a milkman. He kept chickens in his yard. This man never got involved in anything in his life. One day his chickens got out and he tried to fetch them back in. A detachment happened to be passing by, found him outside and picked him up as well.
Allies they may have been, but the Americans in Athens made a point of distancing themselves from British actions.
The American ambassador, Lincoln McVeigh, who had moved in and occupied the quarters of the Gennadius Library, which belonged to the American Archaeological School. He was in there when some British soldiers came in and very thirsty from the fighting, tried to draw water from the well. He ordered them out in no uncertain terms and said, we're neutral, get out. See, that was the attitude of the Americans, this extraordinary thing.
At home, there was an outcry in the press against the action of British troops in Athens. It was led by the Times newspaper.
It so happened that I had the occasion to lunch with Robin Barrington Ward, who was then the editor of the Times, and I did my best to explain to him of my experience, how I tried to explain what had taken place in Greece. He was quite impervious to anything that I had to say. He was totally and entirely sympathetic to the EAM-ELAS position, and he thought that Churchill had gone completely off his head.
In the House of Commons, Churchill said, "There is no case in my experience, or at least wartime experience, where a British government has been so maligned and its motives so traduced in our own country by important organs of the press or among our own people." He defended his action by claiming that for 3 or 4 days or more, it was a struggle to prevent a hideous massacre in the center of Athens, in which all forms of government would have been swept away and naked, triumphant Trotskyism installed.
I suppose there must have been 40 to 50 men and women who were involved in final policy decisions on this, a dozen or so responsible British and American newspapers. They were very well informed, very intelligent, and at that moment in the war, they were enormously motivated to support Churchill's policy if they possibly could. Now, you've got two alternatives. Either one man, Churchill, was wrong on this business, or else 40 to 50 well-informed, well-motivated men and women, all at the same moment and on the same issue, all took leave of their senses and regarded Churchill as being wrong when he was really right. Well, I mean, the saying is, you can pay your money and you can take your choice.
On December the 18th, the Royal Air Force headquarters in Athens was attacked and overrun by ELAS.
2 o'clock one morning. Surrender, comrades! We were waking up much better than the alarm clock, and there were a few shouts, and there we were, I presumed, at war. We dressed, went downstairs to the where the rest of the chaps were, and more or less sat about talking about what was happening. No one really knew except that we were being fired at.
And suddenly there was, you know, like a noise like a Venetian blind going up and down several times. Then everything went quietly, and then quiet. A little while later, it was like, bang! And the shell came right through the Venetian blind at the window and went into the wall, way over to my right, and burst in the wall, luckily. Otherwise, I probably wouldn't be here now.
With RAF personnel now, alas, prisoners, Churchill flew out to Greece with Eden on Christmas Eve. He met with resistance leaders and Greek government ministers for 2 days. The outcome of the meetings was that a regency was set up under Archbishop Damaskinos. Churchill was finally persuaded that the king could not return to Greece before a referendum. Meanwhile, the fighting went on. With aerial superiority, the British gained the upper hand 2 weeks later. On January the 11th, ELAS met British representatives with the Greek government and signed an armistice to take effect from the 15th. Throughout the fighting, the Russians remained silent. Since July, their military mission had indicated Russia's desire not to get involved, although the Greek Communist Party knew nothing of Stalin's agreement to stay out of Greece.
The Soviet military mission didn't get involved at all in our problems. They kept a consistently neutral position to the point of suspicion. When we asked for support in arms and ammunition, their response was always, "We will report your request." But right until the end, in December, we did not receive a single Soviet bullet.
At the Yalta Conference in February 1945, Stalin reconfirmed to Churchill that he had complete confidence in British policy in Greece. Churchill replied that he was much obliged to him for his attitude in this matter.
There was a lack of political foresight among the Greek leadership. They should have seen that the two great powers would each try and get as much for themselves as possible at the end of the war. And in that power game, our leaders should have realized that Greece would be put in the British sphere of influence.
What we can claim is that we left Greece with a free choice after the war, and this is what we aimed to leave them with. Main purpose, that is the purpose of us as a mission with the Greek resistance, was to ensure that no armed force could seize a monopoly of power when the Germans left. And this we did indeed achieve, and this, I think, is why Greece is a parliamentary democracy today and not just another East European puppet state behind the Iron Curtain.
I don't think the December events were a revolution. December was really a resistance by EAMELAS against giving up what it had won and against giving in to the British and Greek government demands. EAM was squeezed. December was a forced reply. As the British say, EAM was cornered.
Churchill fought like blazes to get to retain Britain in the Britain's influence in Greece, and that's what had happened. And of course, I think Churchill too feared anything which had the sort of mark of socialism on it, because he thought anything was socialist was communist.
Churchill is one of the greatest agents of the victory against Hitler. And nobody can dispute his enormous contribution to the struggle against Nazism. But for us, the Greeks, he was the greatest tyrant because he continued to keep Greece tied to Britain.
On February the 15th, 1945, the Greek government met with representatives of ELAS and signed the Varkisa Agreement. The government agreed to an amnesty for all political crimes committed during the December fighting and to remove from power all those who had collaborated with the Germans. In exchange, ELAS agreed to surrender its arms. But neither the amnesty nor the purge of collaborators was carried through.
The Varkiza agreement betrayed the resistance. Our leaders tied us up, hand and foot, and handed us over to those who had collaborated with the Nazis.
Η σωστή επιλογή θα έπρεπε να ήταν να αποχωρήσει από την συσκέψη.
The right choice would have been to abandon the conference and declare that they would continue the struggle outside Athens. We had this option. The whole of the ELAS army was intact.
Within weeks, thousands of ELAS partisans were imprisoned. And 2 years later, in the mountains, came the outbreak of the Greek Civil War.